Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee. Unfortunately, our colleague Fergus Ewing is unable to join us this morning and has asked us to accept his apology. And additionally, the Deputy Convener, David Torrance, is unable to join us this morning, but we are joined in his place by Marie McNair, MSP. So a very good morning to Marie, who has, of course, been here with us before. So we have no declarations to make on this occasion. And we can proceed to agree as item one that we will take items four and five in private. That's our work programme and also our further consideration of the draft report into our inquiry into the A9 duelling project. Our colleagues contend. That brings us then to agenda item two, which is the consideration of continued petitions. We have eight continued petitions to consider this morning. The first of these is petition number 1862, which is to introduce community representation on boards of public organisations delivering lifeline services to island communities. This is a long-standing petition, which was to deliver community representation on boards of public organisations, which was lodged by Rona Mackay, Angus Campbell and Naomi Bremner on behalf of the Youth Economic Task Force. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 24th of January when we agreed to write to the Ethical Standards Commissioner, the then Minister for Transport, and to local authorities and community councils representing island communities. Now, the Ethical Standards Commissioner, while not responsible for defining what attributes might be required for those undertaking a board position, tells us there is nothing in the Code of Practice or accompanying guidance that would preclude ministers from including island knowledge as a requirement for board membership. We've also received responses from the Shetland Islands, from the Western Isles and Orkney Island Councils, which support the principle of adding island knowledge or lived island experience that they be added as essential criteria for the skills matrix for boards delivering lifeline services to island communities. Now, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport tells us that while the skills matrix will vary depending on the skills of the current board membership and the specific board vacancy, on every occasion, applicants are asked to demonstrate a knowledge and understanding of how lifeline services affect our island communities. And we've also heard from the Cabinet Secretary and her officials that more needs to be done to attract and appoint island residents to these boards, with an emphasis on advertising vacancies as widely as possible. So I think we've pursued the aims of this petition quite well. Therein lies the position. There's nothing precluding this. The government agrees it still needs to try and achieve more. I wonder if we have any recommendations that might be made. Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Convener. I agree. I think we've done an extensive piece of work looking at this issue, and I think it is valid to have conducted that. But unfortunately, I think we've reached the end of the road, and therefore I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that consideration has been given to appoint island residents to the boards of public organisations responsible for delivering lifeline services to island communities, and the Scottish Government state that, regardless of what other skills may be required, applicants are asked to demonstrate a knowledge and understanding of how lifeline services affect island communities.
Thank you. Our colleagues content that we proceed on that basis? So we thank the petitioner for bringing the petition to us. It has been an interesting petition, and I think we have clarified issues to some extent, and we will see now what difference is made. If in the next Parliament it still seems that these issues are as they were without improvement, then obviously we would very much welcome the petitioner considering whether it would be worthwhile lodging a fresh petition at that time. The second of our continued petitions is petition number 1931, which is to improve the R100 rollout by prioritising properties who currently have speeds of less than 5 Mbps. This is lodged by Ian Barker, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to prevent digital exclusion for rural properties and their households by giving priority in the R100 programme to properties with internet speeds less of 5 Mbps. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 22nd of November last year, and at that time we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and to BT Openreach. Now, after that meeting, we received a written submission from the petitioner highlighting his ongoing frustration that people with speeds of below 5 Mbps are not being prioritised, and expresses that he feels like people are being digitally excluded. And I'm sure colleagues I know will have had letters from constituents on these issues themselves. The Scottish Government's response informs us that approximately 52,000 properties remain eligible for the R100 voucher scheme, and as of December last year, 3,639 connections were delivered through the use of these vouchers. Additionally, around 460 vouchers have been issued, with approximately 100 further vouchers requested. Now, Openreach has stated that it routinely reviews the sequencing of its build programme to identify additional build that can be brought in. This is linked to the delivery of connections to an additional 8,653 properties through contractual overspill. There's what we've been told, but it does remain a live issue, and I don't know whether colleagues have any suggestions how we might respond in that light. Mr. Golden.
Yeah, I think there's some further work that needs carried out in this petition to understand how the voucher scheme is working or not, as the case may be. It may be down to access to broadband, so even if you can pay for something, if you can't actually get it, then it's slightly irrelevant that you've got a voucher for it. So I think we should write to the Scottish Government to ask whether, in light of the low uptake of vouchers, it believes the Scottish Broadband Voucher Scheme is an adequate approach to providing connections to properties in rural Scotland.
Are there any other suggestions from colleagues? Are we content to proceed on that basis?
Yep.
We are. So we'll keep the petition open and we will proceed to make that further inquiry. Petition number 1934, to develop an educational resource on gender-based violence for all year groups in high school. This next continued petition has been lodged by Craig Schooler on behalf of Greenfalds High School Rights and Equalities Committee. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to work with Education Scotland to develop an educational resource on gender-based violence for all year groups in high school. And this resource should educate on the causes of gender-based violence and ensure that young people leave school with the tools to help create a safer society for women. Now, we last considered this petition at our meeting on the 8th of November last year. And at that time, we agreed to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills and the University of Glasgow. At that time, the Cabinet Secretary indicated that the Gender-Based Violence in Schools Working Group was expected to publish its national framework to help schools, to help them tackle sexual harassment and gender-based violence. Now, that framework has now been published, and the Cabinet Secretary has stated that the Scottish Government has committed to commissioning an independent review to establish positive practice and further areas of improvement during this parliamentary session. The submission also highlights the revised statutory teaching guidance, which includes a section to support learning and teaching on consent and health relationships. The Scottish Government consulted on the guidance last year and is analysing the responses. Meanwhile, the University of Glasgow's written submission provides details of its evaluation of the Equally Safe at School intervention. The aim of the evaluation is to determine whether the intervention is effective and cost-effective. Its work will take place with six schools over 2 years, with the full results expected in December 2026. So, colleagues, have we any suggestions? Mr. Chowdhury.
I think we should write to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to ask what the next steps will be following the publication of the Gender-Based Violence in Schools framework, and when the Scottish Government intend to commission an independent review of the framework, and when it expects that review to continue.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. Are there any other suggestions? Are colleagues content? They are. We will keep the petition open then and act on the recommendations suggested by Mr. Chowdhury. That brings us to petition number 1990, to introduce a Scottish Parliament question session for young people. This was lodged by Jordan Anderson And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to request the introduction of a monthly chamber session to allow young people to put questions to the First Minister. And as was the case at the time that the petition was originally lodged, her cabinet, but of course would now be his cabinet. We last considered this petition on the 25th of October 2023. And at that time, we agreed to write to a number of stakeholders and to the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, of which I should declare I am a member. We've received a response from the National Union of Students, which states that it has no petition, a position on the petition, and that it aligns itself with the views of the Scottish Youth Parliament. The corporate body's response confirms that it has not had representations from the Scottish Youth Parliament to request more sittings in the Scottish Parliament building. The response highlights that a new annual exhibition slot has been added to the terms of its partnership agreement with the Youth Parliament, and the next sitting of the Scottish Youth Parliament is due to take place in the Scottish Parliament at the end of this month, on the 31st of October and the 1st of November. In the light of that, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Golden.
Thanks. I think it's an interesting suggestion, and indeed the work that's been carried out to highlight to relevant authorities has been useful. But I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the committee's report on participation considered a similar recommendation and concluded that it was not in support of a public question time, which is part of a formal parliamentary business, as it raises too many difficulties, both of practice and principle.
Thank you. And yes, of course, Mr. Golden points to our own deliberative democracy inquiry. This was one of the issues we did pursue, and it had attractions, but it also had the very difficulties that Mr. Golden's identified. Are colleagues content to close this petition? We are. So we thank Jordan Anderson for the petition, and I would very much urge the issues raised within it to be pursued through the Scottish Youth Parliament. And of course, the Parliament and the corporate body would consider requests actively made through that body. Petition number 2038 to commission suitable NHS services for people with hypermobile Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and hypermobility spectrum disorders. This petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission suitable NHS services for those with hypermobile EDS, HEDS and hypermobility spectrum disorders, HSD, and to consult with patients on their design and delivery. We've been joined in our consideration of this petition today by our MSP colleague Michael Mara, who's taken an interest in this petition. Good morning, Mr. Mara.
Good morning, Convener.
At our last consideration on October the 4th last year, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and the National Services Division. The Scottish Government's response provides information about its engagement work with individuals living with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and hypermobility spectrum disorders. The submission highlights its work on the Rare Disease Action Plan and states that the officials would be happy to meet with the petitioner to discuss that work further. The National Services Division's submission explains that a short life working group they facilitated found that there was a need for specific specialist expertise in Scotland to improve patient care. One of the reasons this work has not progressed is that the National Services Committee determined that care might be better delivered through the development of a set of clinical guidelines, a patient pathway of care, or a networked community of practice. Now, the petitioner's response states that this is exactly what they've been trying to achieve. However, they have been informed by Health Improvement Scotland that there is not enough evidence to support the creation of signed guidelines. And the petitioner has shared that NHS Wales has now committed to co-creating a hypermobility pathway for primary care to help GPs diagnose and manage these conditions. The petitioner also outlines statistics to support their view that Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and hypermobility spectrum disorders are not necessarily rare disorders, as they very often go undiagnosed. Now, we've also received a written submission from our colleague Emma Roddick. She's unable to attend the meeting this morning, but obviously her submission is available within the on the website. But it touches on her experience of living with chronic pain and the value of meeting with other people who have similar experiences to her own. She acknowledges that doctors cannot be expected to know everything, but believes that there should be a nationally agreed standard for pain pathways to ensure that people do not fall through the cracks. So before we consider where we might think to go next, I invite Michael Marra if he'd like to speak to the committee.
I greatly appreciate the time of the committee, convener, being afforded the opportunity to address you. This is the first time obviously I've spoken to this petition, but there have been some developments in my own involvement with it that I wanted to update the committee on, if that can be given that opportunity. So my involvement with the petition is in relation to constituents who are living with the condition and have faced challenges in access and treatment and support, and that includes some who have waited 20 years for diagnosis. As I have lodged a motion for members' business which has gained cross-party support. I'm grateful for that, and I look forward to having that debate in the Chamber when it is scheduled. And last month I was pleased to host a round table in Parliament with EDS UK and researchers from the University of Edinburgh, Catherine Berg and Derval Dockrell, who shared the findings of their recent research into EDS. And that revealed people waiting decades for diagnosis, with a large proportion either leaving Scotland to access healthcare in England or paying for private treatment. And that demonstrates, I believe, that there is a clear gap, testified in that research, in the services available in Scotland to people living with HEDS and HSD. And for that reason alone, I would urge the committee to keep this petition open for further consideration. I'll come on to some potential actions that I would suggest. So Ehlers-Danlos syndromes are a group of 13 heritable connective tissue disorders caused by genetic changes that affect connective tissues. Each type of EDS has its own set of features, but some common features across various types of EDS include joint hypermobility, skin hyperextensibility, and tissue fragility. This can cause a person's joints to dislocate, their skin to be stretchy. They bruise easily and wounds can take a long time to heal. And I have heard powerful testimony from constituents about living with this condition, including being in constant pain, living with reduced mobility, limited quality of life and impacts on their mental health. Hypermobility EDS is the most common type of EDS, accounting for about 90% of the cases that we're considering today. Various statistics have been used on the prevalence of the condition. The convener referenced them in his opening remarks, and I would point out, as he did, as colleagues from EDS UK have also done, the crucial distinction between rare and rarely diagnosed. One study found that 1 in 500 people had a diagnosis of HEDS and HSD, so it certainly requires more investigation. The Scottish Government's submission, if I can come on to those, convener, of 12 October 2023 stated the Government was considering what additional stakeholder engagement activities may be required throughout 2024. It also stated the Rare Disease Implementation Board intended to hold a number of involvement meetings early in 2024. However, as EDS's UK's latest submission states, they do not feel that these meetings are an appropriate avenue for developing a specific care pathway for EDS, as the meetings covered a range of rare diseases. The response to the committee from the National Services Division on 13th October stated that the ongoing diagnostic, treatment and care board needs of HEDS and HSD patients are the responsibility of individual health boards. But clearly, given the experiences that I've already highlighted and highlighted by various constituents, that through research and the work of EDS UK, that is simply not working at the moment. Petitioner's most recent submission obviously calls for a pathway for NHS diagnosis and care for HEDS and HSD, nice and signed guidelines for Ehlers-Danlos syndromes and hypermobility spectrum disorders, a coordinated multidisciplinary approach to diagnosis and care for people with HEDS and HSD, and support and training, crucially, for healthcare professionals to deliver this. So I would commend the staff and volunteers for EDS UK for their continued determination on this issue, and note the progress that has been achieved in other UK nations to date. For example, in May of this year, again as referenced by the convener, NHS Wales have committed to co-creating a hypermobility pathway for primary care to help GPs diagnose and manage the conditions. So colleagues at EDS UK have met with community health pathways teams in Wales, and that has helped to progress the work on that pathway. Research and lived experience has shown GPs are often not aware of the condition or the potential options that are available for treatment. Publishing a pathway would give a clearer guidance to GPs and lead to improved patient experience. And I have to say, at the round table that we held in Parliament, there was a clear desire from the general practitioner workforce to have that information to make it available to them. So as far as I'm aware, we do not have community health pathways in Scotland. But I think there is the possibility for some collaborative working across the two nations of Scotland and Wales in this regard. And I would suggest that the committee might contact NHS Wales to find out more detail on the progress of that work to date and how this might be applicable to Scotland.
Thank you very much. A couple of good suggestions in there. Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you. I think we should keep this open and taking Mr. Myra's suggestions also to write to the Scottish Government to ask whether it accepts the petitioner's view that Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and hypermobility spectrum disorders are not necessarily rare disease as they often go undiagnosed, and in light of that, ask what action is being taken to improve diagnostic service beyond the rare disease action plan. Also, highlight NHS Wales' commitment to co-producing a hypermobility pathway for primary care and ask whether a similar exercise could be undertaken in Scotland.
Thank you. I note, in addition to Mr. Mara and Emma Roddick, that a number of our colleagues from Bob Doris, Angela Constance, Bill Kidd, Pauline McNeill, Mary McCallum, Daniel Johnson, Martin Whitfield, Michelle Thompson have all been engaged in relation to this issue. So I think it has attracted a considerable amount of attention and concern amongst parliamentary colleagues. I'm happy to take forward all of the suggestions that have been made. And I think maybe we might also like to ask and maybe pursue this view that the current progressed way of moving forward may not be the best model to actually achieve the end result. And I think it would be useful, I think, to put that point to the Scottish Government and see what their reaction to that is, because I think that obviously is very clearly felt. So we'll keep this petition open. I think we've got a number of ways in which we can continue to pursue it. And I thank the petitioner again for bringing the petition to us, and to Michael Mara for joining us this morning. Thank you very much. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2041, which is to exempt community healthcare staff from parking charges, lodged by John Ronald. And this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to encourage local authorities to exempt staff working at community healthcare facilities and who don't have access to free on-site staff parking from on-street parking charges and allow them to care for vulnerable and sick people in our country without it costing them thousands of pounds a year. We previously considered this petition last December on the 6th, when we agreed to write to the Health Secretary COSLA, the Royal College of Nursing, the Trade Union Unison and Unite, and the Allied Health Professionals Federation. Now, responses in support of the petitions asked have been received from the Royal College of Nursing, Unite and the Allied Health Professionals Federation. And while being mindful of the need for sustainable travel, the RCN highlighted that parking arrangements form part of the working conditions for their members and impact on recruitment and retention rates. In its response, the Allied Health Professionals Federation note that if Allied Health Professionals are required to pay for parking, they are effectively being penalised for accessing their workplace. The then Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care's responses notes the expectation that all NHS boards in Scotland should have a policy in place that enables staff to be reimbursed for valid expenses, including car parking charges, but is clear that such policies should not be extended to cover staff who drive to work and park their car all day at their base of work. We have also received a response from the petitioner, who remains concerned that community health staff using their own cars for work are being discriminated against. So, do members have any comments or suggestions? There is a route for the reimbursement of these charges when community care workers are out in the community and have to park off street. But there's also a very clear view that it's a different view to that in relation to permanent parking on a daily basis at the fixed place of work. So any suggestions for actions? Mr. Golden?
Should we do one final follow-up to write to NHS regional health boards to ask what support and reimbursement is available to community healthcare staff who are required to use their personal vehicle as part of their role?
Yep, I'm content. Are we all content? Mary McNair, are you content that we pursue that a little bit further? We are. Right. Well, thank you very much. So, again, to the petitioner, we'll keep the petition open. Having been directed to the view that local authorities have got this ability, let's just try and find out whether, in fact, there is access to that opportunity for staff in practice. That brings us to petition number 2048, to review the Fast Stroke Awareness Campaign. This has been lodged by James Anthony Bundy, and I see Mr. Bundy is with us in the gallery this morning, along with his mother, I believe. Yeah. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to increase awareness of the symptoms of stroke by reviewing its promotion of the Fast Stroke Campaign and ensuring that that awareness campaigns include all the symptoms of potential stroke. And we've been joined in our consideration of this petition by our MSP colleagues Stephen Kerr and Alexander Stewart. Good morning to both of you. We previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 6th of December last, when we agreed to write to the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, the Stroke Association, the Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland. And I'm pleased to say we've received responses from all those I've just listed, which are detailed in our papers for today's meeting. So let me turn to those as well. Do I have them to hand? Thank you. The Minister tells us that work is ongoing to establish the existing levels of awareness of stroke symptoms and FAST, with consideration also being given to how awareness of less common symptoms can be increased. The Minister also indicated that there are no plans to deviate from supporting the use of FAST, though this position will be regularly reviewed based on the best available evidence. We've also received a submission from the petitioner expressing disappointment that the Scottish Government has no plans to deviate from FAST. The petitioner has also highlighted that where clinicians are reliant on the FAST test, this can have devastating effects for patients presenting with less common symptoms, as was the case for his father. Responses from the Stroke Association and Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland highlight the need for further research before committing to the use of BFAST in a new nationwide campaign. And therefore, before I ask the committee, I wonder whether both Mr. Kerr and Mr. Stewart would like to address us. Is one of you, Mr. Stewart?
Good morning, convener. I'm delighted to be back again at this committee and once again to speak on this petition. And once again, I commend and I congratulate the Bundy family for their tireless campaign they've been doing throughout the time of this petition and prior to that. Interesting to hear what the Minister is saying, convener, but I do think there is still room for further discussion about how we take this forward. And we've already heard how that the BFAST is an opportunity to develop things in the future. And we do understand that the acronym is there and that there's a real challenge to ensure that the message is out there. But there is still the risk of the false positives about the developing the consequences from this process. And it's all, we've all felt that throughout this whole campaign that it's better for someone to go to A&E to find out they have not had a stroke than to sit at home and dismiss some of the, because you're not falling into the FAST scenario. So you think that there's nothing wrong because you don't have the symptoms that you would have under BFAST. So I think that in itself is still an issue we have to discuss, and the Minister needs to, and the meetings I've had with the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary, along with the Bundy family, there has been quite a lot of discussion on that. But I do think that it is, you know, the Scottish Government can work with Public Health Scotland and NHS boards to trial BFAST. And it would be good to see if that could be achieved. Because if we did then have a trial, that would give the opportunity to access real results and real data. And that would allow the data to make informed decisions. And that's what we're talking about here. It's informed decisions under these circumstances. Because if you, as I said before, you already know if they don't fit into the criteria, then they are not given the opportunities, they're not given the scan, they're not given the processes. And that subsequently has meant that individuals have lost their lives, as Anthony Bundy did. So I do believe that there's still room for improvement where we take this. So I would urge that there is an opportunity to try and set up a trial within potentially one health board to see where we can actually take this. And that would give us a fair trial and a fair an advantageous report as to what is actually happening and give more data, because I believe it's the data that we need to have that will then create the case to ensure that this is progressed, convener. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. Mr. Kerr, have you anything you wish to add?
So I'm here because James works in my office. I've known him and his family for a long number of years. Everyone will be aware of the circumstances that have brought this petition into being. I suppose I just want to say I completely agree with everything that Alexander Stewart has said. What he has made a very reasonable request that this be fast, be trialled somewhere. I'm at a loss, frankly, convener, to understand why the Scottish Government, the Minister, isn't prepared to consider research, even a consideration of the existing body of research that there is to support the adoption of BFAST. It has been put to colleagues and the family that if there was an adoption of BFAST, there would be an influx of people arriving at A&Es believing that they were perhaps having a stroke. The reality is that if that were to happen and we were able to save lives, and in this case it's very close to home with James and his family, if a life could have been saved because the medical staff were aware of BFAST and that the clinicians' prioritisation was governed by a fuller appreciation of the symptoms, so the a faster diagnosis could have been made, then perhaps a life could have been saved. And therefore, I find it almost unreasonable that the Minister isn't prepared to consider even the existing body of research in her considerations, and that the government isn't prepared to undertake some or commission some research of its own. The cost of all of these requests is minimal, but the value of a life is infinite.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I think actually the issues raised in this petition are of considerable interest to colleagues in the committee. And I think there are a number of things that we might now reasonably consider doing to try and take forward consideration of the petition. Colleagues, do you have any suggestions from Mr. Golden?
Thanks, convener. I think, firstly, we should write to the NHS Regional Health Board and the Scottish Ambulance Service seeking information on any local stroke awareness pilots they have undertaken, including the outcomes of those pilots. And in addition, I think we should write to the Scottish Government highlighting the contributions from Mr. Stewart and Mr. Kerr regarding data, consideration of trials and commissioning research, but also to seek an update on its work to establish existing levels of awareness of stroke symptoms and whether this work includes consideration of the awareness among clinical staff of symptoms beyond those captured by the FAST test.
I don't know if colleagues are minded, but I think this might be one in which we are prepared to take some further evidence. So I wonder if we might consider convening a roundtable relevant stakeholders to discuss these issues with the committee. And this might include the Stroke Association, Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland, and other organisations, if the committee is content to leave that to the clerks and myself to agree. And that we might then be able to have a more detailed discussion to tease out some of these issues, all of which I think then might put us in a stronger position as a committee to address these issues directly with the Minister. Are colleagues content that we do that? We are. So I thank Mr. Stewart and Mr. Kerr. I note the presence of the Bundy family again today. And I hope you will be content that we are going to take forward these issues, and hopefully the evidence session itself, together with the written further work that we've done, will give us an opportunity to pursue the issues raised in the petition. Thank you very much. The next petition is petition number 2049 to introduce buffer zones outside migrant accommodation. This petition is lodged by Gillian Petrie. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce buffer zones outside migrant accommodation to prevent anti-migrant groups from gathering in these spaces and help protect occupants, including asylum seekers and refugees, from harassment and intimidation. We also considered this petition at our meeting of the 6th of December 2023, when at that time we agreed to seek information from the Scottish Refugee Council, Just Right Scotland, COSLA, Police Scotland and the Mayor's Group. And in its response, Police Scotland stated that it considers current police powers as sufficient to address any unlawful behaviour which may arise in the vicinity of migrant accommodation as a result of protest activity. The Mayor's group believe that any decision about buffer zones would be a matter for the Home Office as the contracting authority for migrant accommodation, while also highlighting its use of private security teams to help manage protests with support from the police. The response from Just Right Scotland states that their position that the rights to freedom of expression and peaceful assembly are fundamental rights and lawful interference should be kept to a minimum and done cautiously. They also believe there is much more that can be done in Scotland to ensure that those seeking asylum are safe and secure in the place they are living and in the community, with the response highlighting wider concerns about the use of institutionalised accommodation for people seeking asylum. In the light of the responses received, do members have any suggestions or comments for action? Mr. Gould.
Thanks, Convener. I think we've done some degree of work on this, and ultimately, from the evidence which you have just highlighted, I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that Police Scotland already have powers to address any unlawful behaviour which may arise in the vicinity of migrant accommodation as a result of protest activity.
Colleagues, are we content on that basis to close the petition? We are. Thank you very much. So I thank the petitioner, but you will understand from the evidence received from Police Scotland that hopefully the protections required are in place. That brings us to agenda item 3, which is the consideration of new petitions. And we have a number of new petitions to consider this morning. And as I always do before we begin consideration of new petitions, I just point out to those who might be watching or following these proceedings, or a petitioner may have tuned in to see us discuss their petition, that in advance of this consideration, we do invite the Scottish Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, to give us a briefing in relation to the issues raised. And we also ask the Scottish Government for a preliminary view on the issues raised in the petition. And we do that simply because historically, it was the case that the committee would instruct those two things on first consideration, so we simply shortcut so that we can get to a meaningful discussion. The first of our petitions this morning is petition number 2103, and this is to legislate to standardise the prescribed learning hours for primary and secondary schools in Scotland, lodged by Dr Julie Badcock. And it calls on exactly what the petition says, to urge the Scottish Government to standardise these prescribed learning hours for primary and secondary establishments across all local authorities in Scotland. The SPICE briefing explains that the length of the day and the number of learning hours is a matter for each local authority. It also explains that ministers have the power to make regulations which would set the minimum number of learning hours each pupil should receive. In 2023, the Scottish Government consulted on using these powers to prescribe the minimum level annual number of learning hours. That consultation closed in June 23, and the Scottish Government is actually yet to set out what its next steps will be. The Scottish Government's submission states that it is carefully considering the very large number of responses and intends to publish its analysis of these responses in due course. Its submission also states that the Scottish Government does not support any reduction of learning hours in any local authority. This was expressed in a letter to all local authorities last year. Ministers are working to reach an agreement with local government on this issue, and if no agreement is reached, the submission states that, and I quote, ministers remain open to taking steps towards utilising its powers to regulate the number of learning hours. So the issues in the petition appear to be very live at the present time. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Chowdhury.
To keep this petition open to write to Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to ask for an update on the Scottish Government's work with local authorities to reach an agreement on the provision of learning hours, including information on how this work is expected to progress, when information on this outcome of this work will be available. Also, when the analysis of responses to the consultation of prescribing minimum hours will be published, and given that the consultation closed in June 2023, an explanation as to why publication has taken this length of time.
Yeah, I think the committee can accept that if there are a very considerable number of responses, it might take time to analyse those, but we are now looking at 15, 16 months really since the consultation closed, and I think it would be interesting to understand what the ongoing delay is in regard to that. Are colleagues content with that? We are. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2105, which is to safeguard Scottish listed buildings at risk of unnecessary demolition. This petition has been lodged by Lydia Franklin on behalf of Save Britain's Heritage, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to set a minimum evidence requirement to prevent unnecessary use of emergency public safety powers to demolish listed buildings. And we are welcome. I'm joined this morning by two of our parliamentary colleagues, Carol Mockin and Paul Sweeney, both former members of this committee, so welcome back once again to both of you. The Spice briefing explains that local authorities are required by law to intervene where a building presents a danger to people in or about that building, to the public generally, or to adjacent buildings or places. Where the local authority considers the required action to be urgent, it can carry out that action without first obtaining the usual statutory consents. Now, this includes where demolition is considered the required action. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that works undertaken on listed buildings without prior consultation should be limited to the minimum necessary requirement to protect the public until proper consultations can take place. The Scottish Government's response states that it is for the local authority to determine the most appropriate course of action, taking into account the particular circumstances of each case, and that it is not possible for guidance to be specific about the approach required when the instances of dangerous buildings are unique and require a risk-based approach to determining the appropriate action. The petitioner's written submission states that in order to adhere to the legislative requirements and good practice, enhanced guidance is needed to set out the minimum structural evidence and processes required before undertaking demolition works to listed buildings. She recognises that the approach to managing dangerous listed buildings is unique and requires a risk-based approach, but it is her view that this does not prevent the creation of additional guidance to ensure the appropriate expertise are sought when assessing what action should be taken. And so I wonder then, before we consider what we might do, colleagues, we'll hear from Carol Mockin and Paul Sweeney. Have you agreed between you who Carol Mockin is going to address us first? Carol Mockin, what would you like to say?
Thank you, Convener. I really appreciate the opportunity to come along and speak at the Petitions Committee this morning. And obviously I'm here to support the petition PE2105. And I do support the petition on behalf of my constituents right across the region that I cover, which is south of Scotland. I've been contacted many times about this important issue of not only saving beautiful and historic buildings in the region for future generations, but also because there does seem to be a need to enhance the guidelines around the dangerous buildings and how we proceed with that. And I say that because my experience since I have been elected and working with constituents have been that we have a number of ordinary members of the public who really care about their communities and about the buildings and the history of the villages that they live in. And so they raise quite often, well in advance of any emergency situation, with the council, with the local authority, or with other public bodies, they've raised this on many occasions, asking if we could have some work in advance so that we don't get to an emergency situation. But unfortunately, in the 3 years that I have been a member, I have agreed with a number of my constituents that this is not something that seems to be a priority and seems to work very well. And that what we do end up is the use of this legislation around emergency building care. And of course, my constituents understand that it is important that the public is protected, and there's no question of that, but they do feel that there is a loophole in terms of that we get to that and then we use this legislation, whereas if we had some enhanced guidelines. I want to in particular thank my constituent Esther Clark, who has really worked tirelessly to address this in Ayr where she lives, where there are many historic buildings and we know that they may be getting to this point. So I think it is with some urgency this petition would be well to be supported in order that we don't have this unnecessary response when we do feel that there could be some public vulnerabilities. So I would hope that the Petitions Committee would continue to consider this petition. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to members of the committee for hearing this petition. This is an issue that has been a bone of contention for me for many years. Growing up in Glasgow, a city that has experienced significant demolition and destruction of its built heritage over the years, and really my engagement and motivation to get in politics in many ways was coloured and motivated by my desire to try and preserve the built heritage of the city and my community. And I guess it begs the question, why do all these buildings seem to be getting demolished a lot of the time, and what is the processes underlying that? So I spent a great deal of time interrogating these issues and getting to the nub of what's going on. And I could go back to 2004, the demolition of the Elgin Place Memorial Church in Pitt Street, done unnecessarily 2 days after Christmas, which was undertaken based on no evidence from a structural engineer suitably qualified, right up to the present day, whereas we speak in Sucky Hall Street, just around the corner, the listed ABC, former Regal Cinema on Sucky Hall Street, is currently being demolished, despite there being advice and an assessment from a conservation-accredited structural engineer that the facade could be preserved. Yet that was disregarded, both by the owner of the building and by Glasgow City Council's building control officers, and summarily was served with a dangerous building notice and is currently being demolished without any due process whatsoever. No evidence presented that the building couldn't be saved, at least in part. So that is why this petition is so important. And I think Save Britain's Heritage's engagement came from, as my colleague Ms Mockin mentioned, the Air Station Hotel incident in Ayrshire, where the building had suffered a fire. It was deemed to be dangerous, and South Ayrshire Council, its building control team, came in and started a process of almost wholesale demolition of the building, but presenting no communication to stakeholders, no evidence presented transparently about why that was necessary in its entirety. And even though the local Air Development Trust had commissioned their own structural specialist engineers who were conservation accredited, the top experts in their field, Ed Morton and Ben Adam, who had produced reports saying actually substantially the building could be saved, at least as a shell, that was completely disregarded. There was not even the courtesy of a response from the council in this matter. And this was going over a period of months. So the notion that it's having to happen urgently, i.e. in a matter of hours or days, to safeguard the public is a fallacy. In reality, these are long drawn out exercises that take place over a series of months. Indeed, the ABC incident, the building's been standing in Sucky Hall Street since 2018. And indeed has been potentially a danger to the public since that time, yet in the last 3 months or so, when a proposal from a developer to demolish the building and build a new building has suddenly building control leapt into action and expedited an emergency demolition order. So I would contend that it's subject to routine abuse and manipulation. And actually one of the problems with the process, not even just the dangerous buildings process under Section 29 and 30 of the 2003 Buildings Scotland Act, actually under the 1997 Act, which is the Conservation Areas and Listed Buildings Act, there is no independent arbitration, no independent scrutiny of the evidence presented by developers or those applying to demolish listed buildings to test whether the evidence presented is sufficiently robust. What I would suggest is a reasonable ask in the petition is that the Conservation Accredited Engineering Register, which is maintained by the Institution of Civil Engineers and Institution of Structural Engineers, is used as the basis for the advice necessary or the sufficient qualifications necessary for an expert to judge the condition of a listed building when it is in a dangerous condition, and indeed when individuals or applicants are applying for a listed building consent to demolish a listed building or a building in a conservation area. I think that would be a necessary enhancement, because I can tell you with all sincerity, this process is subject to routine abuse, whereby soft engineers are commissioned by clients to present reports that basically advocate for their desired outcome. They're not independent. They're commissioned by the applicant. Of course, the engineers are going to do what the client wants. So that's why the process is inherently tainted by bias and under its current guise. And I would suggest, certainly in the case of listed buildings, there should be a much higher threshold of evidence necessary to justify its demolition. Often, I mean, in the current Buildings at Risk Register, there's 2,214 buildings on it in Scotland. And over the last 3 decades or so that the register has been active, 658 buildings, listed buildings in Scotland, have been demolished. And there's probably many more out there that haven't made it to the register in the first place. I would say most of those, if not all of them, could have been saved in whole or part had a more proactive approach been taken by the planning authorities and the right expertise was in the room assessing these buildings. No planning authority in Scotland has a conservation accredited registered engineer employed. It's not an in-house set of skills. In the same way that I wouldn't go to a GP to seek treatment for a brain tumour, I would go to a neurosurgeon. I think there needs to be the necessary expertise commissioned when necessary to ensure that we don't unnecessarily lose the nation's built heritage. And I think it's a perfectly reasonable contention in this petition that guidance should be enhanced so that in cases of listed buildings at risk, that when a Section 29 or Section 30 order is served, a conservation accredited engineer must be commissioned to investigate the building and determine what could be saved, if anything. And I think that independent approach would be much better at achieving outcomes such as saving the facade of the ABC on Sockhill Street, which is currently being unnecessarily demolished and is a permanent loss to our national heritage, which I think is a crying shame. I could recite numerous other examples. The Springburn Public Halls in 2012 could have had its facade preserved. It was entirely demolished. The Elgin Place Church, maybe known to some as the Shack Nightclub on Pitt Street, unnecessarily demolished, and numerous other examples. Air Station Hotel, just the latest in a litany of these buildings lost in the nation. So I would encourage the committee to consider further actions by asking stakeholders to present further evidence. So I would suggest the Institution of Civil Engineers, the Institution of Structural Engineers, to talk about why the care register is so important and why that is a good professional benchmark for enhancing the guidance in Scotland. I would suggest having Lydia Franklin and Henrietta Billings from Save Britain's Heritage along to discuss in particular their case at the Air Station Hotel. I would suggest having examples of conservation accredited engineers currently practising in Scotland, such as Ben Adam at Narrow Associates, Will Rudd Associates, also Ed Morton, who's a care engineer who was involved with the Air Station Hotel. I would suggest engaging with the Scottish Historic Buildings Trust, the Architectural Heritage Society of Scotland, Glasgow City Heritage Trust, whose director is Neil Murphy, the Scottish Churches Trust, the National Trust for Scotland. Their representative might be good to have Liz Davidson along, who's been heavily involved in the Glasgow Building Preservation Trust and efforts to save the MAC, the Glasgow School of Art. The Air Development Trust, of course, who's been heavily engaged with Air Station Hotel and the saga there. They could recite that the flaws in that process to the committee in detail. Esther Clark might be a good starting point. Also Robin Webster, an eminent conservation architect, top of his field in Scotland, who could relate some of these issues as well. So there's just a set of suggestions of people to bring along. I've got many more in my sort of reservoir of suggestions, but I would encourage the committee in the strongest terms to inquire deeply into this issue. I am absolutely fully clear that there's flaws in this current process and that the current regulations are open to regular and routine and well and pretty sophisticated abuse by consultants, planning officials and indeed applicants and property developers. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. Unsurprisingly, compelling advocacy in support of the aims of the petition. I am old enough to remember the era before multiplex cinemas, when the ABC cinema, the Regal in Sockerhall Street, was a regular place to go. I can recall Charlton Heston going there for the premiere of Earthquake with surround sound, where we were shaken in our seats during the earthquake, and it seems the cinema survived that but doesn't survive the kind of calamities visited upon it by Glasgow City Council's planning process. And I think the argument you make is an interesting one. I think most of us are aware of buildings that are being lost without necessarily having fully understood what processes were in place that led to that demolition. Sometimes it will, of course, have been completely necessary and unavoidable. But there are sometimes just the suggestion that there is a shiny new model that might be better suit the owners, and they're keen to pursue it. And you know, I'm minded in relation to Glasgow of the Odeon Cinema on Renfield Street, where that magnificent facade was preserved and is incorporated into the much newer building structure that was allowed to be developed on what had been the site of the auditoria of the of that cinema complex. So there are solutions that can be found if people want to find the imagination to take them forward. I'm quite interested in this, but I think this is something that the public are genuinely interested in. So I'm minded to... I don't know if we've got a room in Parliament big enough for all the people Mr. Sweeney was suggesting, but I am minded to conduct a sort of informed roundtable on what is happening with this this process and whether or not legislation might not be more... appropriately drafted to give a little bit of weight to the idea of conservation accredited registered engineers having a say in all of this. And I think those arguments are quite interesting. I just wonder if there's anything we might do to inform that panel of any suggestions from any of what we might do in the first instance. Anything, yeah, Mr. Golden?
Thanks, convener. Yeah, I agree. There's quite a lot in this, and actually for perhaps decades, many of our buildings have been unnecessarily demolished, in my view, across the whole of Scotland. So I think initially we should write to the Scottish Government to ask how it can be confident that existing powers contained in the building standards legislation and supporting guidance are sufficient to protect listed buildings from unnecessary demolition. Furthermore, how should local authorities determine whether partial or total demolition is the only appropriate solution to address a safety risk in cases that are considered to be urgent? In addition, what level of community engagement might be appropriate for local authorities to process? And whether it has considered producing additional guidance to set out the minimum structural evidence required and the provision of appropriate expertise in cases where a listed building is being assessed against the Building Scotland Act 2003.
And I think we might specifically ask whether that would include the use of a conservation accredited registered engineer. I think that would be useful. So I think we'll write to the Scottish Government. Our members content that we do so in the first instance. And then I think it would be useful to have a round table in relation to all of that. The clerks have noted the various recommendations. I might, in this instance, invite the clerks just to liaise both with the committee but also with Mr. Sweeney to see whether we can identify the key individuals who might be able to participate in that. I think if we had all the people you suggested, they would get a minute each and we would still not have enough time. So we'll keep this petition open. I think it's one of enormous public interest and we will pursue the recommendations that the committee have made and that we've heard from both Paul Sweeney and Carol Mockin, who I thank very much for joining us this morning. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2107. Which is to use more money recovered from the proceeds of crime to support community-based charities that train animals to assist in the detection of drugs. This has been lodged by Kevin Cragans on behalf of the Shetland Times Limited and calls on the Scottish Government to direct more public funding recovered through the Proceeds of Crime Act to support charities such as Dogs Against Drugs, which are vital to their communities and play an integral part in the seizure of drugs and criminal assets. The background to the petition tells us that the charity Dogs Against Drugs had a direct involvement in the seizure of more than £360,000 worth of drugs and over £14,000 of cash just last year. Due to financial pressures, the charity has had to let one of its dog handlers with the petition go, with the petition suggesting that changes to the way in which the proceeds of crime are distributed could help these pressures. The Spice briefing notes that while Police Scotland do not publish the number of dogs within their dog unit, a Freedom of Information response from April 23 states the police had 144 dogs across Scotland, with this figure being relatively stable for a number of years. In Orkney, Shetland and the Western Isles, local policing teams work with charities, such as those highlighted in the petition, to carry out detection activities, though they do not fund them. Responding to the petition, the Scottish Government note that money recovered through the Proceeds of Crime Act are paid into the Scottish Consolidated Fund and currently used to fund the Cashback for Communities programme. The current phase of the programme focuses on delivering a range of trauma-informed and person-centred services and activities for young people who are at risk of entering the criminal justice system. This response also goes on to highlight a grant of £10,000 awarded to the Dogs Against Drugs through the Serious Organised Crime Community Grant Scheme, and a more recently a one-off grant of £30,000 from money ring-fenced for serious organised crime. This is expected to relieve the current financial pressures while officials consider longer-term options for funding. So, do members have any suggestions for action? Yes, Mr. Goldman.
Thanks. I think we should write to the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs to seek further details on the work being undertaken to consider longer-term funding options for charities that play a vital role in the seizure of drugs and criminal assets.
And I should perhaps just have noted that we'd received a late submission, which colleagues will have from Beatrice Wishart, our colleague Beatrice Wishart, on this petition. But that suggestion from Mr. Golden, we keep the petition open and we write in as suggested. Are we content to do so? We are. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2108, to obtain a second medical opinion before detainment under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act of 2003, lodged by Andrew Muir. And it calls on the Scottish Government to require medical professionals to obtain a second medical opinion before a person is detained under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act of 2003. The SPICE briefing explains that a short-term detention certificate authorises the patient's detention in hospital for 28 days, in order to determine what medical treatment needs to be given to the patient and to provide that treatment. The Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act specifies criteria that an approved medical practitioner must confirm have been met in that the criteria have been met in order to use a detention certificate. The Act requires the consent of a mental health officer before using a detention certificate. If the patient has a named person, they must also be consulted and have their views taken into account. In England, the decision whether to detain a patient is made by an approved mental health assessment, a mental health professional, following an assessment by two doctors. When the 1983 Act was being debated, the importance of the independence of the two doctors making medical recommendations was stressed in order to avoid collusion, influence or interference with clinical judgment. The Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport has responded to the petition, outlining the use of short-term detention certificates and highlighting the right of appeal. The submission also highlights reducing coercion as one of its priorities emerging from the Scottish Mental Health Law Review. The petitioner shares his view that the certification process does not contain sufficient safeguards, as the mental health officer granting consent is not necessarily independent of the approving medical practitioner. And his view is that the law review was not fit for its purpose, and that while it stated that coercion should be reduced, it is not clear how this will be achieved. And the petitioner would like to see supported decision-making as the norm rather than substituted decision-making. So, important issues. I think I recognise the name of Andrew Muir. I think he may have raised petitions with the committee previously. Comments or suggestions from colleagues? Mr. Chowdhury.
I think we should keep this open and write to the Scottish Government to highlight the requirement for an assessment by two doctors before short-term detention in England, and to ask how it can be confident that just one medical opinion is sufficient for cases in Scotland.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. Are there any other suggestions for action? No, are we content to keep the petition open? So we'll keep the petition open, Mr. Muir, and we thank you for raising it with us, and we will write and see what response we get in the first instance. That actually takes us to the end of the public session this morning. Our next meeting will take place on Wednesday, the 30th of October. We'll now be moving into private session to consider agenda items 4 and 5, and I thank again Marie McNair for substituting for David Torrance and joining us this morning. Thank you very much.